Hey friends, come to think of this. The world has become so competitive and giving birth to people we describe as movers and shakers. See how they excel in their craft and contribute to the development of their community and their society. Their stories are fascinating and inspiring. Their examples are worth emulating. Their successes are great. Here comes a platform that tells those stories with the people behind them coming on board to do so. On Board with Ernest Kanjo is that journey which ferries you into the lives of Africa's illustrious sons and daughters, at home and in the diaspora. The one-on-one top profile interview is every week on Apex One Radio. On Board with Ernest Kanjo, be Kanjo's next passenger.
Hello there and welcome. This is On Board with Ernest Kanjo. Arguably, the last 2 to 3 years have been the most spectacular in the history of Cameroonian music, at least in terms of the volume of production. Quantitatively, there has been an amazing bloom. The frequency of new tracks that pour into the music market has left no one indifferent. This new order has led observers to strongly hold that music is the best thing happening to Cameroon culture of late. Convincingly, one can easily subscribe to this assertion. It may, however, be simplistically argued that the switch from albums to singles clearly explains the speedy influx of tunes. Also, sometimes logical explanation that computer technology makes the making of music easier as opposed to the scenario in the past has come into play. Buttressing this argument, it is heard at certain quarters that were it not for the digital beats we have today, which would harness all the scintillating sounds provided by the various instruments, only a few musicians would have been able to bring raw stuff in the studio, as was the case in the past. Furthermore, some school of thought have opined, rightly or wrongly, that it doesn't require much ingenuity and patience to weave urban music as it would for Makossa, Bikutsi, Asiko, Bottle Dance, and other indigenous genres. To this thinking, urban music, which is easily patched up without painstakingly concentrating on every little aspect, as would be the case with the aforementioned. These arguments are plausibly convincing in nature and could be advanced to cut a long story short. But a deeper yet critical look into the discourse may bring forth balanced arguments. And spanning the lens, one can easily see 3 things that have stood out in this new dispensation of computer technology, which is said to have facilitated things aside. Talent, skill, and creativity. The current generation of musicians is an amazing factory of intelligent composers, brilliant song arrangers, fine vocalists, and skillful choreographers. One of such talented new generation singers is Myra Maimo, Cameroonian artist based in the United States of America. Myra has proven beyond reasonable doubt that she is meant for the art of music, and that explains why her works have been highly applauded. But just how did she get into music? What has her experience been this far? What does she have off her sleeves in the coming years? This and more are some of the questions the artist will be providing answers to on board this great radio journey. She is our main passenger today. This is On Board with Ernest Kanjo. Welcome. Mm-hmm. Peace there by Myra Maimo, the main passenger on board this radio ride. You're listening to Apex One Radio. We are broadcasting from Columbus, Ohio, United States of America. This is On Board with Ernest Kanjo. Let us now go back to Maryland, where our main passenger has been with us since the start of this program. Myra Maimo, once again, you are welcome.
Thank you so much for having me. Thanks.
Okay. Now, could you tell our listeners, for their sake, especially those who haven't come across you yet, who Myra Maimo is?
Well, I am Cameroonian to the core. I come from the Northwest Province, precisely Sault. And I come from a large family. I have 6 siblings. And I grew up in a lot of laughter and freedom. Just like, I'm pretty sure you would identify with that as well.
Definitely.
A lot of fun, a lot of playing outside, a lot of music. Mm. And I guess that is the one thing that I've taken with me. I just love to be free and love to make music and sing whenever I have the chance to. So, apart from the music aspect, I also like I like to work really hard, and I do that especially in my field, which is business.
Right.
So I dabble in both worlds. I go in and out, and sometimes they come together in nice ways. So, yeah, that's pretty much where I am.
Hmm. Could you take us back to when you were growing up? Was there anything that marked your childhood, something you would always love to recall?
I recall a lot of teasing from my brothers. Because I used to be crazy. I would sing everywhere. I would come up with these crazy melodies and sing them everywhere at home, and after a while, you know, they'll get tired of me singing at home, and they're like, okay, they would start picking on me and teasing. And yeah, that sort of really helped me. It toughened me up for the world, I guess, while I developed what I really like to do, which is singing. Because I would get up my neighbors, kids, and we would make bands, fake bands, of course, with tins and sticks, and we would play the drums and sing, and I would come up with crazy songs, and it was just fun. It was a lot of fun. We all had a lot of fun. So those are some of the things that I remember, but I also remember how much music we had at home, because my parents had lots and lots of play records, and it would span across genres, so it wasn't just Cameroonian music, it was a lot of jazz,
okay,
a lot of country music, so I got exposed to quite a lot, and it was lovely, it was a lovely time. I wish we could go back. when things get too serious, I start wishing we were back then when we were young and free and everything was just good.
Okay, now, Myra, take us into your educational background, primary, secondary, and high school education.
I went to primary school at C.S. Bailey. Lots of fun memories.
That is in Bamenda.
Lots of fun memories. Yes, that's in Bamenda. And I did most of my education in Bamenda. And then from there, I went to St. Paul's Bilingual Comprehensive College. It's a Catholic, then it was like the only Catholic day school.
Okay.
So that's where I did 5 years of my first cycle education, and then I went to GBHS Bamenda for high school. And after that, I traveled to Germany where I studied international business, and I got a master's in international management there as well. And then I traveled to the U.S. where I had a master's in business administration.
Was there any particular reason why you chose to study business?
Yes. How should I say this? When we were, as a kid, it just came naturally to me. There's this story I want to tell you. My mom was very, very angry with me at that, but yeah. So my mom, she would never really give us money to take to school because we didn't live that far away from school.
Okay.
So we never really had, lunch money because we were expected to go back home and eat. And I had all these friends who came from like really far, so they would have money all the time, and we were a clique. So since I could handle money better, they all gave me the money to keep. And after a while, we would split it up because we were friends, and because I was doing all of them a service
right.
by keeping the money. So I never really got to spend my own part of the money. They would spend everything. And afterwards, they'll come back to me and borrow. And I was like, yeah, you can have it. It's not like I have any use for it now anyways. But then you're going to have to pay a little bit of premium on that. And, yeah, so it was quite interesting having to make money from nothing, not having anything at all.
Right.
And my mom was so mad when she heard about it. Oh, my goodness, I was in trouble. But those were the little things that made me understand that that was something I liked doing.
Right.
I just like to create things and just see things grow from nothing. And especially if it helps somebody live better, why not, for God's sake? So when I came to Germany, that was like the obvious step for me to take. And I haven't regretted anything about it, really. I love what I do.
Cameroonian singer Myra Maimo is in the United States of America. She doubles as an international business person. Myra Maimo is the main passenger on board with Ernest Kanjo this day. Now, Myra, do you use your international business skills in your music?
I do. When it comes to the strategic planning of things,
okay.
I do. I try to. It's easier to do that with some other person when you have a client. It's different when you're doing it for yourself.
Okay.
I'm just going to put that out there. I prefer to have some other person with, of course, with me, partnering with me to do it, because there's a lot of things that I would miss because it concerns me or because I'm too emotionally attached that I won't do right. So I don't have my eyes on everything. So though it influences it, I try to keep away from making all the decisions by myself.
Okay. Let's get into the crux of the matter, music. For how long have you been in this art?
For as long as I can remember. I started singing and dancing in how I would call it in Cameroon, Kati bands,
right.
with little kids as early as 8 or 6 years old. And it's pretty much been the same. When I went to school, I joined singing groups, the school choir, And then by the time I was 15, I was singing in studios, doing backup for artists.
Okay.
And I literally haven't stopped singing ever since.
Hmm. Wow, that's fantastic.
Yeah. And then even now when I'm not singing or when I'm not out there on the stage, I like to do praise and worship because I ultimately believe that everything that I do should be for the glory of God. So
right.
I try as much as possible to spend time sharing my gift with people in the church as well as everybody outside.
Hmm. Now, scores of musicians I've spoken with have told me that they got into music thanks to a parent who inspired them because they sang in a church choir. Was that the case with you? What motivated you into music?
First of all, like I already mentioned before, it just came naturally, first of all.
Okay.
And then I discovered that after a while, whenever I was happy, the first way I would express it would be in song.
Mm.
And when I was feeling depressed or sad or angry, I would immediately rush and get a pen and start writing stuff down.
Okay.
And of course, I'll get teased by my brothers for doing all of those things. They call them fake songs. But that was my primary way of expressing myself. So I knew early enough that this was something that I never really wanted to let go because it was my the way I let emotions out. So that was one of them. The second one was all these records my parents had at home.
Mm.
They would play them like all the time, and we would switch one after the other. So you would never come to our house and not hear music.
Mm.
So it was just constantly running. And then after that, when I was 15 too, I discovered that it was actually a nice way of making money.
Mm.
So you could go sing at a studio, and you end up having maybe some 10,000 that you probably didn't think of having that weekend.
Mm.
And for a 15-year-old, that's a lot of money.
Right.
That's a whole lot of money. So it was just everything just came together, as I can say. It was one thing leading to the next, and everything was just pointing towards that direction.
Mm. Now, some famous artists today went through a formal training in singing. Others were born singers. Where do you belong in this?
I've never had any training. Mm. Let me just put that out there first. I've never, ever had any training in music. I think it just comes naturally. I think that's the case with a lot of African artists.
Okay.
We don't necessarily have to go to school and study all these things, but we still come up with nice stuff.
Mm.
It doesn't mean that we shouldn't. We shouldn't. It always helps a whole lot when you get the training because you know what you're doing at least, or you can better channel the things that come to you instinctively.
Mm.
When you have the training, it's easier to put everything together. But with the little that we have, first, we don't have the instruments in schools for teachers to train kids and all of those things. We just make do with what we have. And I must say that so far it's been generations, and what we've been producing isn't that bad at all.
Mm. Okay. And so what genre of music does Myra do?
I do, I would say I'm a complex artist. Let me put it out there first. I primarily define myself as an Afro soul singer because I'm into more of the soul, the reflective and the introspective things.
Okay.
I like to have a message. I like to, make my audience think twice about, mundane things, maybe just the way you go about life, maybe the way you look at God, or if you are an atheist, just little things that make you think twice, because that's what I look for in music. So I like to share that as well. Not that pop music is not good. I definitely do pop too, but even so, I like to have a positive message or an inspiring message. Okay. So I'll say I'm an Afro soul, Afro pop.
Okay.
Artist.
Afro soul, yes. Afro pop. Okay, Myra, let's have some music then. We'll be right back with you.
Thank you.
Yes, I promise you this. Yeah, I promise you this. 2 out of 4 are so sure to fall. 1 other standing, 2 are so sure to crawl. There you believe the stories about it. You may want to retreat, be without great intentions.
And that one is titled Whatever I Promise. The artist is our main passenger on board this great radio ride. Her name is Myra Maimo. You're listening to Apex One Radio, broadcasting from the United States of America.
Whatever I promise you on that day, whatever maybe no matter it comes this way, I'll keep it, never leave it. I reassure you can be sure this is the way it will be. It's not getting
okay, Myra, this one is titled Whatever I Promise. What are you saying in this song?
This is a story about a couple who are married and who just got married, and they're talking, literally talking about how things are, the complications of blending, joining two families together.
Right.
So the lady is promising that she would work with the husband,
okay,
no matter what. And of course, there are going to be challenges. There will be relatives who say that she doesn't probably meet up to their expectations. that almost always happens. Yeah. Mm. Maybe the way she does things isn't the right way and stuff like that. But that the main thing that bonds them is the love, and that should never go away.
So is that the lesson you passing across through this music?
This was actually written with my label CEO, Mbachi Hale.
Okay.
So he is like the primary person here. So this song, it has nothing to do with me.
Oh, okay.
I wasn't married then. Mm, yes.
All right.
Yeah, it's just the story that we are very familiar with.
Right.
He was married though, so he, that was his story, or some relative story, but it's a story that we all know about.
Okay, let's listen to it again. How old is this track?
They were released in 2011.
Okay.
So that should be five years old. Oh my, that's a long time. 5 years old.
Okay, this is On Board with Ernest Kanja. You're listening to Myra Maimo, the main passenger on this great radio ride. Apex One Radio, broadcasting from Columbus, Ohio, United States of America.
You are listening to On Board with Ernest Kanjo, a top-profile face-to-face interview that presents some of Africa's illustrious sons and daughters, making the continent proud. On Board with Ernest Kanjo, just on Apex One Radio. Get on board and be Kanjo's next passenger.
Okay, this is On Board with Ernest Kanjo. Myra Maimo, you're welcome back.
Thank you.
Now, tell me, how many albums do you have so far?
I have one album and one single and another one to be released this year in July.
Right.
Okay. Hopefully.
And when did you release your very first album?
The very first one was released in 2011.
Okay.
And then later on we had, in 2012, we had videos for Killing Me and Whatever I Promise.
Mm.
So a year after.
Okay. And how many tracks do you have on that maiden album?
I have 11.
11 tracks.
Very different tracks across genres.
That is so ingenious, and I would imagine it would have taken you quite a lot to package all of that. Tell us about that first album. Just what did it take you to come up with it?
It took us, we were in the studio for 6 weeks.
6 weeks.
To record everything, yes. Record everything and have the instrumentalists coming and play. It was 6 weeks. So it was, we were working constantly from morning to night. It was fun. It was a lot of fun.
Hmm.
I enjoyed the process with my producer, Mbachi Hale.
Okay.
He is an amazing songwriter, an amazing musician. And it was so easy to work with him. So we literally just went there. We think alike when it comes to the kind of message that we want to have. We don't just want to sing about stuff that's going to be forgotten.
Mm.
We want to sing and be able to change somebody's life or encourage someone just to go out and be a little bit more positive.
Right.
And yeah, so it was a very fun process. I totally enjoyed it.
And where was?
And I of course love the song.
All right, where was that? In Germany or in the United States?
That was in Germany.
Ah, okay.
That was in Braunschweig, in Germany. Yeah.
And who are some of the artists you work with?
Primarily, the only artist other than Bachi Hale is Naomi Achu.
Mm.
Dear sister, she has a heart of gold.
Mm.
Yeah, so I did do a remix of Killing Me with her, which was a huge success. People really liked it.
Okay, and how did that album do in the market? What was the feedback from the public? What were people telling you?
It did very well. It did very well, I must say. I was really very humble. Everywhere I went, they were just proud to have somebody, who did something like that.
All
for
right.
me, it was just, us doing what we love to do. But for the people I spoke with, the Cameroonians and, not only Cameroonians, even Germans and British people, and it was inspiring. It was it was encouraging, which was the whole goal behind the whole thing. We wanted to be able to encourage people. So it was nice to have them recognize that we were doing the message that we had, for example. Yeah.
Right.
It was really good. And then some of the songs did extremely well. The gospel songs on the album, which is Answered Me, and they did really well on the European gospel chart.
Hmm.
Both of them were on there for about 2 months on number one position.
Right.
And then I Need Him was also top on the Dance Terra charts for 2 months too. So it was we had three number one hits, which went on for 2 months. So that's like amazing. And I'm really very thankful for that.
Right.
And then Killing Me was like the hit for the African audience, because that was the one song that went really close to the African culture.
Mm.
So that's the song they identified with the most. And yeah, reason why people wanted more our fans wanted more, so we had to do a remix for them.
Right. Oh, so did you say you have just one single?
Yes, right now I have only produced one single, and that is Anogo Tire.
Ah, okay. Right, we'll come back to that. But time for us to talk about Killing Me, which you did with Naomi Achu. But before we get into talking about it, I would like you to just have a piece of it, eh?
Okay.
They be hating on my creativity. Hating just because I'm everything they wanna be. If I wear purple, it would be a bad color. If I'm just in a bikini, it would be a bad summer. They be the tummy say I no go ever blow. If it be hot like jigga for my toe. Haters looking left and right like a gamma lizard. I go cook them for my pot like chicken gizzard.
Going up the ground, I said they're killing me.
Killing Me, the key song in the 2011 maiden album of Myra Maimu. And of course, this one is featuring US-based Cameroonian song heroine, Naomi Achu. You're listening to On Board with Ernest Kanjo this day. And of course, our main passenger is USA-based Cameroonian singer, Myra Maimu. And of course, this is Apex One Radio, broadcasting from Columbus, Ohio. Myra, you're listening there to Killing Me with Naomi Achu. Tell me, what is this track all about, and what was the message you intended to whip across it?
The song is, first of all, very dear to me because I use it as my anthem. Mm. When I wake up and I'm not very motivated, I just think of this, and it just it inspires me, because we all have people who don't want to see us succeed. Everybody has one person who probably isn't in line with your goals for the future, and sometimes we get really disappointed and we let it weigh us down, and it affects our results. Because somebody stopped us from doing something, or somebody said this about us, we get so depressed and life is so bad and everything, and then we start hating on people. Oh, this is my enemy and that, and all of that negative energy at the end of the day, it doesn't really help anybody. So what we say in the song is, you should use that as a motivation. If somebody defies you, somebody tells you, okay, you cannot do this, do it just to prove that you can, without necessarily reflecting it on the person. So every negative experience should be transformed into a positive one if you want to have positive results in the future. You cannot let negative talk or negative energy alter your future or your results. You cannot let that happen. So that's principally what the song is talking about.
Every negative experience should be transformed into a positive one if you want positive results. The words of Myra Maimu,
yes,
explaining the message she intends to whip across through this very beautiful one titled Killing Me. And of course, the artist says, as per the African perspective, this track is considered as the key one in her 2011 maiden album. You're listening to On Board with Ernest Kanjo. Back to you, Myra. The video of this, the video of this track happens to be quite captivating, and I must assure you that the feedback was really great. Where was it shot?
Thank you.
How long did it take you to complete this work?
We didn't plan too much. I was studying then, and I had just 2 days. I had a test, not even a test. I had an exam on Monday. So we had just 2 days to record. I left my university, West Virginia University, and went to D.C., where we shot the video. And we actually shot two videos. We shot Killing Me on a Friday, I think, and then Whatever I Promise on a Saturday. So we literally did both of them within 2 days. And I came back. I went back to school.
Okay, we shall listen to it again. Then, when we come back, we'll definitely dive into what is making news. Agotaya. Anagotaya, right?
Yes, Anagotaya. Anagotaya,
okay. Right, let's have a piece of Killing Me Again.
Myra, Naomi, we no go tire. Because we're heading to the top, Barack Obama. Money no be there, we be the way of Africa. Now we there for Prada, Oscar de la Renta. When I bring my crown, see the queen of Armenia. But many people that go make them my ginger. See my shoe, it be not love muck. Catch a girl, then they find a thing for chop.
Masterpiece by our main passenger on board this great radio ride. You're listening to Apex One Radio, and of course, the show is On Board with Ernest Kanjo.
You are listening to On Board with Ernest Kanjo, a top profile face to face interview that presents some of Africa's illustrious sons and daughters, making the continent proud. On Board with Ernest Kanjo, just on Apex One Radio. Get on board and be Kanjo's next passenger.
Get on board and be Kanjo's next passenger. And our current passenger is Myra Maimo, whom I welcome back. Myra, you welcome back to the show.
Thank you so much.
Okay, let's talk about Anagotaya, which happens to be your current single. When did you release this track precisely? How old is it in circulation?
It's about a year old. I released it on iTunes and Amazon and all the major music stores. And I literally didn't do much then because I gave birth like a month after to my second child.
Okay.
And it took me a while to get back to a healthy state. So it took longer for things to materialize.
Okay.
With respect to the video and all of that. So that is why it came out this time, this late. Yeah.
Right. So you are back on it now and ready to promote it.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Oh, yes.
Where is this track recorded and who is the producer this time?
It was recorded at Positive Red Studio. That's in Laurel.
Okay.
And then, so many people touched it somehow.
Okay.
And then it went all the way to Cameroon, to Emil Ngumba,
right.
Molindo,
to
M1 Studio, and he did the mastering and the mixing. And the video was done by Terence Jimape. He's a music director in Cameroon.
Okay.
So it's, though it was shot out here, the mixing and the editing was done in Cameroon. So, yeah, a lot of people have been part of this, which is a blessing.
Right.
It's really a blessing. I love the way it turned out.
Mm. And tell me, are you satisfied with the quality of this song? And you think that you can always press your finger on the table to say that Anogotaya is exactly what you wanted?
Oh, yeah. As an artist, you do a song and then you listen to it later on, and then there's always something that you want to change.
Okay.
I don't know if that's the same for other artists, but that's exactly how I look at it, or how my experience. There's always something that I want to take out. It's never really that perfect in my eyes.
Mm.
I always listen to it and I hear something that I probably would have done better.
Right.
But on this track, this was it. This, I heard it after we recorded, and then we sent it to Cameroon for the mixing and the mastering.
Mm.
Once he came back and I heard it, I was just like, okay, this is it. This is it. Like, I don't want to change anything about this.
Mm.
I like it just as it is. Didn't do any change, any more alterations to it. It was just perfect as it was. Because it's a simple song. It's a simple song. So the main thing about it is the message. So I didn't want us to overthink it or over process, just let it be as it is. It's already speaking for itself. So, yeah, it's one of those tracks where I'm like, okay, I really would not have changed anything on this. I'm happy as it is.
Okay, the artist is happy as it is. And, of course, Anogotaya is her current single, which is in circulation. Let's just have a taste of it. Then when we come back, we shall be explaining exactly what she intends to tell the world through this song. Anogotaya, Myra Maimo. Be boiling with so much energy that you don't have plans to get tired anytime soon. So, so tell us, what is it that you're not going to get tired doing?
Just a love song, so it's all about love.
Okay.
I will not get tired of loving, of loving the people around me.
Okay.
Of loving God, first of all.
Right.
Because, and then it also personally loving my father, who passed away 2 years ago, actually. So this was as much as a love song to God in heaven, who looks down on us and takes care of us, as well as my dad, who passed away.
Okay.
And from a girl's point of view, I was referring to the love of a father.
Okay.
Because so many of us girls, we grow up and then, I don't know, something, life happens, I guess that's the right description for it. Mm. Life happens, and then you don't really get the love that you had from let's say your father figure in the real world. It's a different ball game. Players, everything is different. There are, while you have men and boys, right, you never really get the kind of love that you had growing up from your dad.
Okay.
Because that is like the eyes. You can never really do wrong in your dad's eyes. If I can say it that way, when you're young, right? Like, dads are usually all over their little girls, as well as moms are usually all over their boys.
Right.
And then when they grow up, things start changing. You start trying to go here and see, oh, this looks nice. It just could be the same kind of love. And then you go there and you get burnt and like, oh no, apparently that wasn't. And then you move on to the next thing, the next new interesting thing that comes around, right?
Mm.
And you keep on doing that, and you slowly find out that at the end of the day, there's just one person who can love you like you want, which is God, first of all, and then there is you. You have to be able to love yourself.
Right.
Okay. You have to be able to look deep inside, and even though you don't like the things that you see about yourself, you still love yourself enough to want to change.
Hmm.
I mean, if that makes any sense. But yeah, it's all of those things combined. But the primary one is, first of all, that we have a Father in heaven who welcomes us no matter what we've done. Whether we come back with unclean hands or bloody hands or whatever, He is always there for us. So that's like the principal message. And it speaks to me so much. It speaks to a lot of my friends, because this wasn't just my story alone. I was telling so many other people's stories. I just brought the stories together. We, in our search for love, some of us end up just getting one boyfriend after the other, thinking that that's going to give us that fulfillment that we need. Some of us just drink and drink and drink.
Mm.
There's always something you can get, you can get lost in for a temporary period till you find out that that's actually not the kind of place you need to be in. And it always happens.
Right.
It may take a while, but it almost always happens that you get burnt, and then you're like, oops, is it too late or anything? So the message is like, whenever we are in that place, no matter how long we've been in that kind of thing, no matter how hurt or how badly bruised we are, no matter how useless we think we are, there's a Father who still loves us and is willing to welcome us in.
Right.
And that's God.
There is a Father who still loves us and is willing to accept us. Myra, just before I got on board this radio ride, somebody remarked that the video of Ano Gotaya is quite thrilling. Tell us about it.
The video was shot before I gave birth to my daughter.
Okay.
And parts of it were done then, and then I couldn't do anything more because I wasn't feeling okay.
Mm.
And so it combines the winter and the spring, which is, it's in a way, it's nice because everything just came together. Mm. And it was very simple. It was simple. We didn't hire any makeup artists and stuff, like, you know, all the craze that comes in when you're doing a video.
Mm.
There was no such thing. It was just me and my husband and our friends coming together after talking about the message. They wanted to be a part of it as well, because they some of them said it was their story as well, and if it helps to encourage someone out there, they definitely would love to be a part of it. So
right.
It was a group of friends, We shot it at home, actually. So not at home.
When you say simple, it gives the impression that it didn't take quite much as far as finance, material, and human resources are concerned.
No, really, it did. It did not. It did not. Not really. It didn't. That's the whole point. It did not. It's very refreshing and very humbling to see that it's the little things that you just hand over to God, right? Like, take it. Let's just see how this thing goes. Okay. Run with it. Or do whatever you want to do with it. That come out really nice.
Right.
Because the other, we try to do too much. We try to do too much, end up maybe putting on some kind of crazy makeup that doesn't reflect who you are in the first place or doesn't reflect your music.
Right.
And then the video just ends up looking, I don't know, just okay.
Mm.
But this was very simple. We shot most of the scenes at home.
Okay.
We shot most of the scenes at home, especially for the testimonies, the friends and the people, everything was done at home. And then we literally just walked down the street to our park, and we shot the other ones, and that was just me and my husband.
Right.
So this was like the simplest thing I've ever done in my life, like, especially when it comes to videos.
Okay.
This is like the simplest one. So it was a very fulfilling process, and it's really nice to see that we didn't go crazy about it.
Right.
But people still appreciated it.
Okay.
And everybody who's watched it and actually gotten to me, they say they like the video. So that's very, it's a blessing.
Right. And in what other forms or formats do you have this track?
Would you say that again, please?
In what other forms or formats do you have this track?
Oh, there's the audio one that came out first, and then the video. So that they're just two versions, the audio and the video.
And do you have plans of launching it officially?
I don't think so, because it's come to think of it, it's really old. It's about a year old. So I'm into the new ones that I cannot wait to share with you guys. I'm just going to let Anugotaya continue to speak to people.
Okay.
And then we move on to the next thing. So expect really, really hot tracks. This is like so exciting. I literally, sometimes I find myself wanting to go and then push everybody, like, let's get those things onto the stores, like, now.
Right.
Because I think this is like the album is like the most upbeat album as well.
Right.
The more upbeat, because I have just one.
Okay.
One of the album. Yeah. So.
Right. So that next album is what we shall be talking about when we negotiate our next spend in this great radio ride. Myra Maimo is the main passenger on board. With NS Kanji, you're listening to Apex One Radio, and of course, we broadcast from Columbus, Ohio, United States of America. Myra, I'll be right back with you.
Thank you.
No one measured us to the love that we shared, but I realized it's too late to say.
Beautiful piece there by Myra Maimo, the main passenger on board with NS Kanju this day. It is her current single that is in circulation. And of course, the artist is going to confirm to us just right ahead that her next album is coming up in the next couple of months. Myra Maimo, once again, welcome.
Thank you for having me.
Okay, this is on board with NS Kanju.
You are listening to On Board with Ernest Kandjo, a top-profile face-to-face interview that presents some of Africa's illustrious sons and daughters, making the continent proud. On Board with Ernest Kandjo, just on Apex One Radio. Get on board and be Kanjo's next passenger.
And our current passenger is Myra Maimoun. Tell me, Myra, are you confirming that your next album is coming up in July?
I would like to say it's coming up in July.
Okay.
I think so. Pretty much so.
Okay.
I think so.
And yeah. So the first one had 11 songs. How many tracks are we going to have in this second album?
It's going to be between 10 and 11 still. I don't know. I haven't yet made the decision which last one is
going to
get in the mix.
Myra, in the past, musicians never used to have more than 5-6 songs on an album. You're doing 10. Tell me, why would you have so many tracks on an album?
Probably because
is it because you are so inspired and you would write so many songs, you know, at a blow?
I wish I could brag like that, but I can't. I can't. It takes a while to write songs and all, but I just think that if I'm going to put an album out, I should give people something good.
Okay.
I don't want to hurry and give 6 songs because I don't think an album that costs maybe $15 with 6 songs makes any sense. I will not buy anything like that, seriously. Mm. I just want to make sure that people get what they're paying for. So it's not only with the quality of the songs, but it's how many songs actually feature in the album. And probably because I learned from Bachi Hale. Mm. The first album had 11 songs.
Okay.
And we were thinking of doing 15 songs, so we ended up at 11. Okay. So I'm just used to doing it that way, but also I want people to actually get something from the money they're paying.
Okay. Would you want to let the cat out of the bag and tell us about just 2 of the songs that will comprise your next album?
No, yeah, I wouldn't mind doing that.
Okay.
I mean, as long as I'm not playing the song anywhere, mm. I guess that's okay. There's, of course, Anobute. We've already talked about that. Anobute, it also features in there.
Okay.
But then the song that is named after the album is called Unique.
Okay.
And Unique because the album, I just want to give a strong message to everybody who feels less than they actually are, that they are special and they are unique. Mm. So most of the songs refer to that in some capacity. So Unique is like a girl's anthem. It is a boy's anthem too. It's just very, very inspiring and encouraging for girls. It's like a war song, and I can't wait to release it.
Okay.
It talks about girls who have been bullied, girls who have probably been who've been through domestic abuse, mm. or boys who've been through domestic abuse. Anybody who's been through a lot, anybody who's been demeaned, anybody who just maybe you haven't really had it. Some people are just born with some kind of. I wouldn't say they're born with, but they pick up some nuances as they grow, and they end up having self-esteem issues.
And why did you decide to talk about that this time around? Is there anything at stake?
Because I see a lot of people around me, my friends, even myself. We get to doubt ourselves from time to time, especially when you go through a rough period where you don't have as many positive things happening in your life. The human reaction is to, I don't know, usually just think, get in a depressed state or just go to some shrinking and hide and stuff like that. And I just think that we don't get that kind of message as often as we should.
Okay.
So this was like one of the things that I've always wanted to talk about, like, girls, especially the African girl. Let me talk about the African girl, the Cameroonian girl. We're supposed to be the housewife, be everything, and take care of everybody, and very few people actually take care of the girl as a person. I don't know if I'm making any sense.
Sure.
we have a lot of responsibilities, and there are not as many people trying to, like, boost our self-confidence or actually encourage us to go where we want to go because of some cultural issues or just mere lack of a support system.
Mm.
So this was like an encouraging song. When I was writing it, I was thinking about all the girls who were moving around with wood, because I've been that person too. I used to go to the farm and I would work like crazy and come back, and I'll be pissed, sometimes I'll just be happy that I'm able to help my family somehow. Sometimes right. I'll do it just because my mom made me do it. But all of those things, when you do those things, you see people who are struggling, and especially girls who probably don't go to school because they get married too early. Not that it's a bad thing to get married early, but I'm just saying that if you are a person with dreams and you're not able to fulfill any of your dreams because you don't think you have that in you, or people around you are not telling you that you can actually do it, then just listen to the song. That is it. And then another part of the song talks about revenge. Some of us, that's like this common thing about girls. Girls can't stand each other. Probably because girls gossip a lot and, so, yeah, those crazy things. But there are girls who are very vengeful. You know, because maybe somebody did this and that to them and it was so bad, it hurt so bad, they just have to give it back. So the song also talks about stuff like that, and it talks about the importance of just letting yourself heal after you've had all those wounds everywhere.
Right. Okay. With whom are you working in this album?
My husband. Okay. My dear husband.
So at what stage at what stage is the work, and what are the challenges you are facing as you package this album?
It's mostly just been, first of all, health, because of the maternity period I had.
Okay.
And it's been, the album is self-produced, self-distributed and all, so it takes a toll financially on me as an artist to do all of that. But it's also very fulfilling because I get to do what I want to do.
Okay, so at what stage are you with the album now?
We are pretty much almost done with all the songs.
Okay.
The only things that are left would be to complete a few more, and that's going to be done in Cameroon, and shoot some videos for that. That's going to be done in Cameroon,
right?
Within the next few months.
Okay.
So where we are right now, I think so far God has been faithful. He's it's been an interesting journey, but He's delivered.
Right.
For us.
Okay. So,
I must say,
how different is this album going to be from the maiden one?
This is going to be more towards Cameroon, more towards my roots, because the first one was a lot of, I was everywhere. There was salsa in the album, there was dance, there was Afropop, there was a lot of soul music, there was gospel. I still have a little bit of that, but it's not as widespread as it was. The difference is not as vast as it was with the first album. So this is gonna be, these are gonna be songs that first Africans are gonna identify with a lot, and we're gonna have more upbeat songs than we did in the first one.
Right, Myra. One of the successful episodes in your career, as you mentioned before, is your collaboration with US-based Cameroonian singer Naomi Achu. How did you get to work with her?
Mm-hmm. We have like a family thing going. My husband is Naomi's sister's brother-in-law. Mm. So that's how we got together. But apart from that, I admired her or what she does.
Mm.
Even when I was still in Germany and I had not, married into the family. I love what she does. Oh my God, she's such a sweet person. She has a heart of gold. I keep on saying this. She's great.
Mm.
She's great.
And what was your experience?
She's very supportive.
And what was your experience working with her?
It was exceptional. Like I said, we didn't plan extensively for anything. It was more of like, okay, let's get this done. Yeah, and then of course it took a while for us to get the words and all of those important things, the lyrics. But she did an amazing job with putting the fiery rapper kind of lyrics
right.
that encourage at the same time while defying at the same time. So it was nice. Mm. It was really okay. Nice. I loved it.
Mm.
And she's so easy to work with.
Okay. So who are the other artists you have worked with so far in your career?
I have worked with T-Boy. I don't know. He directed the Anugo Taya video.
Okay.
And we have a song together. That's going to be in the album as well. And I can't wait to share that. That's also very nice.
Mm.
We have that. And we might have a few more. I'm not going to say anything about it, but we will have two or more collaborations in the album.
Okay, her name is Myra Maimo. She is an artist par excellence. She is a brilliant singer, and of course, she puts in her all as far as meaningfulness is concerned in music. She is the main passenger on board with NS Kanjo today, and of course, she's speaking live from Maryland. Okay, let's listen to this one. Then she'll briefly explain. Then we move on.
So strong, got something you've been trying to achieve. It's like everything stands in your way. Feels like you chose the wrong things to do. This is what all dreams do.
And that one is titled "I Encourage You."
There's no reason to stop chasing them. You'll only get them if you stay on track. Some friends may not even share them with you. This is not a reason to give up, no. I am here to say I encourage you. I am here to say please stay strong. Holding tight your dream makes your dream hold you tight. I've been through all that too.
Myra, how would you describe this genre? Which one is this?
I would say, you mean the genre for the first album, or
I encourage you. Yeah, the one we're listening to at this moment.
I Encourage You is adult contemporary.
Okay. And what are you saying in the song?
As the title says, it's an encouraging song. Let me start from there.
Who are you encouraging this time?
It's everybody. Think we all have. It's everybody, because I can say that everybody has gone through some retesting period,
right?
Where you probably have plan A to Z, and you try all of it and nothing happens.
Okay.
Yeah, but I think someone must have gone through that. So this is like just saying that I encourage you. Don't give up, no matter how bleak the situation is. there's always a light in the tunnel, at the end of the tunnel.
Right.
So don't give up. Don't give up.
Don't give up. I encourage you, no matter how bleak it is, there's always light at the end of the tunnel. Okay, let's listen to it a little bit. Then we'll be right back with you, Myra.
Kanjo, a top-profile face-to-face interview that presents some of Africa's illustrious sons and daughters, making the continent proud. On Board with Ernest Kanjo, just on Apex One Radio. Get on board and be Kanjo's next passenger.
Get on board and be Kanjo's next passenger. This is On Board with Ernest Kanjo, coming to you from Apex One Radio, broadcasting from Columbus, Ohio, United States of America. Myra, what are some of the past performances you've had?
I have had quite some interesting ones. In Germany, I was performing like all the time. There's just so many of them. There. Germany, UK, Belgium, and then it's sort of slowed down when I came here because I was studying.
Okay.
And after that, there was the maternity break that I took. So I haven't really performed here as often as I would want, but that is all going to change now.
Okay.
I'm healthy, I'm strong, album is here, and yeah,
we're
getting...
plans for future performances, I guess.
Yes, yes, we have those lined up, which I would put on my website.
Mm. Generally, how would you describe the experience you've had in music so far?
It's been humbling to see. The best part of it is hearing people say how much they were inspired or how much they connected with any of my songs.
Okay.
That's like the highlight.
Mm.
I always say that when I hear that, it completely makes my day.
Mm.
And I don't care how many copies I sold, but that is what I want to do. And when somebody tells me that, honestly, like, this is how they feel or how much it changed them,
mm,
that makes it worthwhile for me.
Right. And,
go
ahead.
Yeah, but there've also been challenges because it's kind of difficult to navigate through the whole. There's a lot of fakeness.
Okay.
I'm sorry, but I have to say that there's a lot of fakeness. Fake smiles and fake things going on around too. And I guess people are just being people. I am just being myself, and every other person is just being themselves.
Mm.
But it's one of those things that you don't experience when you don't have the tag as an artist, or maybe or this popular person who did this, who sang this song, right? People are more real when they know that you are like them. When they start thinking that you're this wonderful person here, everything changes. The way they react, the way they speak to you, and it's just difficult to get real and honest answers and that's the one thing that I still battle with today.
Right.
But again, it's not going anywhere.
Is there any particular problem you face as an African artist practicing the art in the diaspora?
There is, pretty much so. And I got a little bit of it when I moved here. because this was like a new zone for me. Back in Europe, I pretty much had my European Africans in the diaspora with me rolling and enjoying the songs. But when I came here, first of all, I didn't have the time to do the promotion that I needed to do because I was studying. I was doing a lot of things at the same time. So it was kind of interesting, and it's just different out here. The outlook here is different. People want things big, and the bigger you seem to portray yourself, the more people think the more people think it looks good, which is completely different. And especially for the kind of artist that I am, I'm not purely Afropop. Because when it's Afropop, people go all out. They do big cars and right here and there and then, you know, just showing the picture that you're living the life. And I don't do that. I don't do that. And I guess that in a way too, that's like almost the American culture. Big things, big cars, big hair, big everything. And yeah, it's just one of those things. Not that it's bad or something, it's just the way things are. But that's not me. So I'm still trying to find my way out here, how to navigate in here.
Right. Now,
it's still challenging.
Now, a lot of challenges, including tight schedules, having to get so involved in what pays your bills. Where do you intend to take this music career of yours to? Let's look at 5-10 years from now.
I'm always going to be doing music. That's never going to go anywhere. I will always do music. And the good thing is that I have very supportive. My market is a niche market. I don't do purely Afropop. So I don't ride with too many popular people, but the good thing about niche markets is that you have some kind of loyalty.
Okay.
Because, and then when you have an audience like that or fans like that, you have to make sure you keep on giving them a good message, giving them just something to go by. Those who want to think, they would buy music that makes them think. Those who want to dance will buy music that makes them dance.
Okay.
And the truth of the matter is that the niche markets usually have a little more loyalty. And I just love doing what I do, putting out good, positive messages. So I'm gonna continue that way. But I also intend to start my own music label, God willing.
Okay.
That's something that I've planned to do, but I haven't done. Yeah, that's number one on the list in 5 years.
She's going to keep doing what she does. The niche market has its own little bit of loyalty. Myra Maimo is her name. She is the main passenger on board this great radio ride. Myra, we're going to take just a few seconds of break, then we'll be right back with you. Time for us to listen to Please Take It Slow.
Okay.
Gospel piece there, titled Take It Slow by Myra Maimo, US-based Cameroonian singer, and she is the main passenger on board with NS Kanjo this day. You're listening to Apex One Radio. We are broadcasting from Columbus, Ohio. And of course, reaching you out there. Myra, once again, welcome.
Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, take it slow. Tell us, what do you want us to be slow about?
The song says just please take it slow and just give yourself time to listen, give yourself time, God time to act in your life.
Right.
We are usually very, very busy Like, we have everything planned out, right? Like, I mentioned, like, the whole plan A to Z thing. We like to be so much in control.
Mm-hmm.
And when things don't work out, we get really... it becomes a huge blow
right.
to our psyche, to our egos, because we put in so much and nothing came out of it.
Mm.
So this song is literally saying that don't be in such a hurry.
Mm.
Take your time, slow down, and let God act and show you where He actually wants you to go.
Don't be in a hurry. Take your time, slow down, and let God show you where exactly He wants you to go. Myra Maimo is her name.
Exactly.
Okay, now tell me, Myra, how would you assess your country's music industry?
Oh my, I've been blown away. It's amazing. It's so wonderful to see the change that has come. There are so many amazing artists popping up here and there. It's so refreshing. But it's not strange, because having been there, I was surrounded. I just got lucky because I traveled out of the country and then I met Bachi Hale. But there are so many people there who are good, like really good. Really, I used to do music with so many of them.
Mm.
There's Yomo Chris. There's so many of them. They are amazing singers, amazing vocalists, amazing songwriters.
Mm.
But it's just the opportunities that they don't have. That is the problem, the opportunities and the exposure.
And what do you think can be done to solve this problem of lack of opportunity and exposure?
I think we can try, especially Cameroonians who are living in the diaspora, who obviously are living better than those who are in Cameroon. We cannot always wait for things to happen from Cameroon, right, and come and meet us. It doesn't really work that way. In giving back or in sending money to educate some kid, maybe you can just pick some talented artist. Maybe they're a painter or maybe they're singers, right? Just pick one person from there and because those are things that pay now. Before, they used to be considered as I don't know, like, let me use this word riffraff that parents use back home. Like, if you did music, you're a riffraff.
Right.
If you were a painter, like most of the artistic jobs that included doing stuff, or maybe if you were playing football, you weren't ever going to go anywhere. That doesn't minimize the importance of education. Nobody goes anywhere without education.
Right.
But if we can pinpoint some of those people who are really gifted and support them, it's not going to be as expensive as it used to be before.
Right.
To get an artist to come up with an album and then just show some support. There's the internet is helping a ton. It's helping a ton. And we can do more. We can do more. Just support the art, to support the artists back home, and especially out here, we can do more.
Much can be done. Much can be done to support the artists back home. That is Myra Maimo. Myra, we are negotiating the last bend of this radio journey, but then we are going to listen to Answer Me. When we come back, we'll be getting very close to our destination.
Yeah, okay.
It's been a while, adversity's taken the best of me. Hardship and disparity seem all my life's about. Bills and warnings, exit orders, letters and degrees. If it's supposed to be humbling, oh yes, it's got the cloud. It's getting way too heavy to carry. Got a mountain on top of me. Jesus, if you hear, please answer me. Jesus, if you hear, please answer me. Jesus, if you're here, please answer me. Jesus, if you're here, please answer me. Learned people telling me.
Answer me, Myra Maimu, main passenger on board this great radio ride with Ernest Kanjo. This is Apex One Radio, broadcasting from Columbus, Ohio, United States of America. Myra, once again, welcome on board. Ain't we are negotiating our last band.
Thank you. That's so sad, though.
Well,
it was so much fun.
There is always the end to every beginning. Well, but then it's been quite exciting. Tell me, when you are not on a business trip, when you are not in the studio singing, when you are not doing the routine things you do every day, what else are you doing? What are your hobbies?
I love to just sit down and just sing. Just get into myself and think about, I like to just sit and think. I don't know if that makes any sense, but yeah, it helps me a lot. And then it's my opportunity to let out any frustrations or anything. If I need to think and cry about some stuff, I cry about it and let it go. But yeah, I like to do that. I also like to, I like to go for walks. And oh my God, I love my time with my kids just running around and, hearing them giggle the entire time. And yeah, that brings me joy, a lot of joy.
Right.
So, I like football too. I like to play football.
Okay. Not the American football, you mean? Soccer? Or which one do you
mean? No. American football, I just like to watch, please. Okay. That's too dangerous for me.
Right.
Soccer, yeah, football. Real football where you kick the ball.
Exactly.
Yeah, I love that. Yes.
Okay. I know as a Cameroonian, you definitely love to have some Cameroonian traditional delicacy when you go for a party or anything. Which one is that?
I can't believe you're asking this question. Of course, it's fufu and huckleberry and kati-kati. You see, and kati-kati. That's like a different level.
Okay.
So when I have it, I know I've arrived.
Okay. That's exciting. And tell me, do you have some people in the music industry in Cameroon whom you look up to as your role models?
Oh, definitely, definitely. I really, really loved the late Billy Manga. And I love the Nubians. They do soul music, and that is what I love to listen to. So they are like, I really look up to them. But then I also have a couple of new artists who are just simply amazing. There's Daphne, there's Gasha.
Okay.
Of course, my dear sister, Naomi Achu. And it's just going to be nice to see more of those powerhouses pop up, and it would be nice to for all the girls to come together and do something. That would be nice. That would be nice.
All right, Myra, there is this little girl in Kumbu. There is one in Ndop. There is one in Yaoundé. There is one in Limbe. There is one in Boya, who have been listening to this radio talk and have been inspired by all of what you said and would definitely be like you tomorrow. What advice?
Oh my God, that's so amazing.
What advice would you give them?
First of all, that they should believe in themselves, because as women, like it or not, we get told what to do very often. And it's very easy to just go with the flow. And then you forget that part of you or the talent that God put in you. Some of those things people don't need to tell you to do. You sort of feel them. you feel what you feel it from all the way from inside. You know what you like to do and what people want you to do. So my challenge is for our girls to think out of the box, be in line with your dreams and your gifts first, because dreams are different from gifts, but make sure that both of them are going together,
right?
And then think out of the box. Just try to be different. Once you differentiate yourself, you're gonna shine.
Once you differentiate yourself, you're going to shine. With that, we've come to our final destination. We've reached our destination, Myra. And how did you find this radio ride?
This was great. This was great. It's very sad that it's coming to an end. I totally enjoyed my time with you. Thank you so much.
Okay, Myra, we want to thank you for joining us on board this ride, and we hope to have you again some other time on Apex One Radio.
Sure, I would love that. Thank you so much. This was an amazing time.
And so thank you so much, Myra Maimo, for telling your story on this radio ride. It was great spending time with you on board with Ernest Kanjo. And so, for you out there, if Myra's story inspired you in any way, why not just emulate her hard-working example? Success will be at your doorstep if you did. And so, I was accompanied on this radio ride by the entire Apex One radio team. Maxel Adit was the main engineer. My name is Ernest Kanjo, the driver on board. Do have a fantastic time as you keep listening to programs on Apex One Radio. Bye for now, and may God bless you.
Yo me quieren baby, me webe me mu, ye kinye la ye epon, baby ma imunu ma hongo memble, bale ye, burbo basu banke wangwe.
Hey friends, come to think of this. The world has become so competitive and giving birth to people we describe as movers and shakers. See how they excel in their craft and contribute to the development of their community and their society. Their stories are fascinating and inspiring. Their examples are worth emulating. Their successes are great. Here comes a platform that tells those stories with the people behind them coming on board to do so. On Board with Ernest Kanjo is that journey which ferries you into the lives of Africa's illustrious sons and daughters, at home and in the diaspora. The one-on-one top profile interview is every week on Apex One Radio. On Board with Ernest Kanjo, be Kanjo's next passenger.